Let's talk about how we should fund our schools of the future.
Because we've been lurching from one crisis to the next.
It costs money and it's difficult.
But for the general population, I believe that is adequate.
I don't believe that teacher pay in Missouri is what it should be.
And so what you end up having are savage inequalities.
Here's a question for you. What's probably the biggest single driver of school achievement?
All the staff here, this is what we want. Like, this is what we believe in.
The answer won't surprise you.
So pretty much all the teachers are like big parents here.
If you got good staff, whatever you want to do is gonna work.
When we want to talk about improving student outcomes,
Mrs. Pearson, our teacher, makes it really fun.
Attracting and retaining the best quality teaching professionals that we can is crucial.
If you want to guarantee that schools in the future are the best they can be, you've got to keep in place the best staff, and salaries take up most of a district's budget.
So over 80% of schools' budgets are for staffing purposes.
In other words, ideally, the school of the future will have enough funds to attract and retain the best staff, especially teachers.
I don't believe that teacher pay in Missouri is what it should be.
Teacher salaries are a disaster in Kansas.
In the ranking of average teacher salaries across all states, Missouri was 41st and Kansas 42nd.
I believe teachers should have an increased salary.
I think they should be paid more so they don't have to have the second job.
But not all teachers in Kansas and Missouri are paid on the same scale. In Missouri, for example, starting pay ranges from $25,000 to nearly $45,000 a year.
We lost one yesterday to Kearney that's going to pay her, you know, $8,000 or $10,000 more for the same job than we are.
In Missouri, because funding is linked partly to the local tax base, sparsely populated rural districts may struggle to pay competitive salaries. It's an issue for Lathrop and Clinton County, which lie north of Kansas City.
If we could compete from a salary perspective, that would be beneficial.
So what can these rural districts do to try and attract and retain teachers?
And so what we have done in our school is moved to a 4-day school week.
Certainly after our first couple of years, you know, we had some folks going, hey, I think that we're getting a better recruitment of teaching staff.
In 2011, Lathrop went down to a 4-day week. It was the only district in Missouri to do so. Longer days actually mean they have more contact hours with students, and it helps with staff development. The motivation was to save money, but they found also it helps attract and retain the best teachers. By this year, 32 other rural districts have joined them, including neighbouring Clinton County. Next year, at least 58 will be on a 4-day week. Research suggests this is happening mainly to counterbalance inadequate salaries.
So I would certainly hope that we would not be looking at 4-day school weeks as a solution to budgeting.
But it seems that we are. And some districts in low-income urban areas, which also have a low tax base, are under the same pressures.
If they don't have a lot of local revenues, it may be difficult for them to have salaries that keep teachers in the district.
Well, I think there is a direct correlation to district funding and the opportunities that exist for kids inside those districts.
Over in Kansas, you'll hear also that teacher salaries are too low.
The other thing that superintendents have said is that they can't compete to keep teachers.
We have a shortage of people even wanting to enter the profession.
This year in Kansas, there are 22 school districts on a 4-day week. In contrast to Missouri, the bulk of district funding usually comes from the state. But that doesn't mean it's more stable.
Because we've been lurching from one crisis to the next, from one year to the next.
In 2010, four school districts sued Kansas, and the state Supreme Court ruled that school funding was inadequate and so was in breach of the state's constitution. Just recently, the legislature has approved an amount that it hopes will meet the court's direction.
We've heard that the court has the option to just stop funding flowing through an unconstitutional provision, which means our schools would not open at the start of the school year.
However, even with the court yet to sign off on a final amount, some believe that day-to-day funding is already adequate.
And I do believe it's adequate for the general population.
So this is the green room area here.
To the west of Kansas City, Kansas, the Bonner Springs School District is building a new technology center.
We're able to pass a $40 million bond issue without raising anybody's taxes.
So what we see right here in this corner right here is a collaboration area.
The strength of the district's local tax base helps with capital projects like this.
And it's through the additional property taxes that are being built that you have more valuation, which allows you to pay off bond referendums a little early.
The state governments are supposed to help out those districts that struggle to raise money locally. But if many districts in Missouri, for example, are ending up still with too little, is the answer as simple as just raising state taxes to give them more?
We're just talking here about raising taxes.
What we need to do is stop giving away our tax money. We allow for businesses to get tax breaks that are ridiculous.
Well, we need to make education, public education, a priority in the state.
This is our innovation lab, and this is where all the creativity happens.
Despite its weak local tax base, the Clinton County District is determined to invest in its students' future.
And this is my favorite wall in the innovation lab.
But all this was paid for by donations from a Kansas City company and a student's grandparents.
Is that how it should happen?
No, absolutely not. Every school district should have this.
Next door in Lathrop, they would like to offer their students a computer science program.
You know, without some extra funding, I don't think that's going to be a possibility right now.
It's a different story down at Lee's Summit, which partnered with the University of Central Missouri and raised bonds to pay for the Summit Technology Academy.
We're a growing community. We're probably going to be asking our voters to support new schools and that type thing. And that's appropriate, it's needed, and it's super exciting for our community.
Before he took over at Lee's Summit in 2017, Dr. Carpenter was in charge of its neighbor, the Hickman Mills School District.
And meanwhile, next door, in my former district, they're closing schools. Closing schools that are the bedrock of neighborhoods. So how do you expect outcomes to be the same, let alone being future ready?
For some school districts, funding is not an issue, but for many it is. If we're serious about making sure that all schools in the future can recruit the best staff and build the best facilities, we need to be willing to invest the right level of resources across the board.